the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me.
And I say greetings to the saints of the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Welcome to the LaPorte Church of Christ Sunday services. Let us go to the Heavenly Father. Father in heaven, we are grateful to be able to assemble, to be able to pray, to be able to know about you, to be able to worship you. And we pray for your Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit would guide and direct this teacher and preacher today, and you would guide and direct the airways on the radio and satellite and on the internet. Heavenly Father, this sermon, the end of the year, make it effective as a blow against Satan and a blessing to the saints. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Jim?
Okay, we're going to sing out of the blue hymnals here, most of it. And we'll start with song number 271. Standing on the promises, and you have to stand if you're going to sing this song. And everybody is ready almost. Here we go. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I shall shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the hammer storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to him eternally by love's strong cold, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. And you may be seated and turn to song number 473, because when you stand on the promises, we have victory in Jesus. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried to Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming love. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and caught me with his redeeming love. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is good. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How about song number 479? Because to get the victory, we have to march with the soldiers, don't we?
Amen.
Onward, Christian soldiers. Hallelujah.
Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as you walk with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the
Now, song number four. We know when we march as Christian soldiers, we know, Lord, how great thou art. In the key of G. Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sing my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art. Thank you. Lord. Praise the Lord. And this next song, number 250. Come, Holy Spirit. We all need the Holy Spirit. First line is, come as a wisdom to children. But us old guys need a little bit of that wisdom too, don't we? So when we say come as a wisdom to children, we got to act like a kid anyway. We got to come unto Jesus as a child, don't we? Leave all the junk behind. And that's what we're supposed to be on. This is the new year, of the coming of the new year. This is the last day of the old year in the world. And we're supposed to leave behind all the things that happened and we did in the old year. Leave them to God and then walk with Him in this new year to all the blessings and encouragements and promises that He has for us through the Holy Spirit.
Come as a wisdom to children. Come as new sight to the blind. Come, Lord, as strength to my weakness. Take me, soul, body, and mind. Come, Holy Spirit, I need you.
We all know this. Our God reigns, doesn't He? Hallelujah. And we're going to do this in the key of G. Keep your head on. Now, that's not really an A, that's a G. And this next one is not a D, that's a C.
How lovely are the mountains.
Hallelujah. He does. He reigns. Well, Lord told me somebody needed this song. I think we all need it, really, because are you stressed out? Are you worried? Shame on you.
Amen.
Because God says in John 14:1, let not your heart be troubled, didn't he? He said, roll your cares on the Lord. And he said, I came to bring life more abundantly. And this is one of those songs I wrote when we were traveling. And as I said before, Pastor Peters is just a little boring to travel with when he's working on his sermon. So I had a little time to put this together. And here it is, an old cowboy song based on John 14:1. Well, I've rode up in the mountains, God's creation there to see. I've galloped across the meadows with just my horse and me. I've lived a pretty good life, and I've had some times of war. But what always gets me up again are the teachings of the Lord. Because he said, let not your heart be troubled, just roll your cares on him. Let not your heart be troubled, and abundant life begin. Now friends, I've come to tell you, I've got good news to hear. Lord Jesus came to free us from the burdens that we bear. He said if we believe him and trust in him alone, the errors of this world did we, for us he did atone. Let not your heart be troubled, just rule your cares on him. Let not your heart be troubled, and abundant life begin. So when you're in storms of trouble, and life is full of drear, dark clouds upon the mountain cause you to quake with fear, just remember what the Bible says that Jesus came to do. He died upon that rugged cross to save your soul for you. Let not your heart be troubled, just roll your cares on him. Let not your heart be troubled, and abundant life begin. Well, I still ride in the mountains, God's creation there to see. But I gallop across the meadows with Jesus, my horse and me. I'm living in abundant life with no more times of woe. I've learned to heed God's leading hand and the teachings of the Lord. I let not my heart be troubled, I rule my cares on him. I let not my heart be troubled, my abundant life did begin. So let not your heart be troubled, and abundant life begin. Hallelujah. Thank you. Pastor Peters.
Thank you, Brother Jim. That's a good song, isn't it? Amen. Ability to write a song and sing it like that, what a talent. I think we're going to begin this last sermon of the year of course, with communion as we normally do. Something in my spirit tells me that things have been going on in the heavenlies. And those things going on in the heavenlies are going to be made manifest very clearly in the earthly in the year ahead. And so I say, let not your heart be troubled, because I can smell the victory. I can feel it, can't you? And I think that we forget that when the flood came, they'd never seen rainwater before. But he was able to bring it down. I'm going to read here, and I don't know why, how it really ties in with communion, which I'm going to have Brother John pass out the emblems now. But it's something that's going to happen. I want you to be aware that God can make it happen. He's given us a little glimpse of it. And frankly, I don't think we're too far away from it. Most will not be expecting it. I sense in my spirit that the enemy does. And it's what is described in Isaiah chapter 26. I'd like to have you go over there. Starting with verse 19. Whew, wow. Hallelujah. Your dead will live. And it's that simple. Their corpses will rise. Now, people of the world, they don't think of it in these lines, that our God is that great. But our Lord, when he came out of the tomb as the first fruits from the dead, he also just did something so we might all understand it. He let those tombs outside of Jerusalem open up. And they crawl out of the tombs. I don't know how it was done, but I'll tell you this, it was done. And they walked into town, and the Bible says that they talked to the people. And I think it was just a glimpse of God giving us an idea of the power he's got. And there are people that are in the tombs today that have been put there by the alien scum snake terrors. Their blood has been spilled, and most people have no idea that it was even done. It was murder. But those tombs are going to open. I have covered in the past from this pulpit the resurrection in regards to that there is more than one resurrection. Well, this is a resurrection I believe he's talking about, that first resurrection. It says, your dead will live, their corpses will rise, and you who lie in the dust, awake and shout for joy. For your dew is as the dew of the dawn, and the earth will give birth to the departed spirits. Can you imagine? Think about it. Most don't. Most don't think their God can do that. Our God can. Amen. Our God still reigns. And then it says, come, my people, enter into your rooms and close your doors behind you. Hide for a little while until the nation runs its course. For behold, the Lord is about to come out from his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. And the earth will reveal her bloodshed and will no longer cover her slain. Now, our Lord was slain from the foundation of the earth, the Bible says it was God's plan. He came up out of that too. Now, when he came to the earth the first time, people were expecting a warring king. But he came in a different role. And now, no one's expecting him to come as an angry, warring God, with an army that he brings out of the tombs himself, with an army that has been laid there by the enemy, and Satan has been doing everything he can to destroy God's plan. It goes clear back to Genesis 3, where he said there'll be enmity between Satan's seed and Eve's seed. And Satan has had war going on, and we have had people being killed, and we don't even, haven't even known there's a war going on. Now, there is a tendency that when it does go on, we can become a bit discouraged, because it would appear that the enemy is winning. But it's not over. Our God reigns, and if he will not spare his only begotten Son, how will he not freely give us all things? And I've often thought, and I hope you keep this thought in your mind, if our God is for us, who can be against us? All the lions, slanders, bitches, and witches, and dirty dogs, and everything else that a man has to face as he carries on this battle for the Lord, nothing compares to the force that we have behind us. Amen? Victory is ours, and our God is so great that he can open up those tombs and bring them out. And I want to tell you, he's going to do it. Now, Pastor Peters, why don't you prophesy? When? I will. Soon. That'll have to be good enough. But I do sense in my spirit that things are going on in the heavenlies that are going to be made known in the earthly. And I say to you out there, as we enter into the new year, if ever there was a time to get your life right with God, and make up your mind, I'm going to serve him with all my heart, all my strength, all my soul, it is now. And if there's ever a time that you have unforgiveness in your life, it is now time to get rid of it. This is all part of the scheme of the devil as he wars. This is the time for us to be right with God. And communion is set aside by our God for us to take that time to do it. We examine ourselves, and we make sure that if there's something displeasing in his eyes, we want it out of our life. Amen? And if he wants to humble you, then fine, Lord, I'm for that. Amen? If he wants to, well, if he wants to put you through the fiery trial that you got to forgive somebody else, then do it. Because if Satan right now can have his way, he'll take as many as he can, because he's going to go down. This kingdom of his is going to go down. And for you poor, simple little souls out there that think it's unscholarly and not intellectual to believe and talk about Satan, you know, maybe you ought to read your Bible. Amen? There's not only Satan, but there's Satan's children, and I just kind of wonder about these old boys and gals that want to deny that part of the Bible as just to whose children they might be. It's about time for us to be waking up to those facts. Amen? But we are to be the children of God, the children of light, and we press on, we fight on, we know that our God reigns, and we keep our lives right. And taking communion on a weekly basis is part of it. Our Father in heaven, I've already prayed over the loaf and the cup today. I've prayed blessings upon it for those that are yours, that come to the communion table with proper heart, mind, soul. And I've prayed curses upon those that would dare to partake when they shouldn't. Oh, Heavenly Father, may we be found now convicted by your Spirit to put out of our lives anything that is displeasing to you, to have a renewal in our hearts and our minds, and be prepared for the days ahead. And Lord, if there be any unforgiveness on our part towards those that should be forgiven, use your Holy Spirit now, not only to convict us to do so, but to help us to do so, because I feel in my spirit there are those that need to have that forgiveness. Lord, you forgave us of our sins, and you made it possible by giving us your only begotten Son. And we remember that. And we remember right now that if you would give us your only begotten Son, you'd give us anything, and that you would be with us. We're so grateful for that. And we remember the great gift. We remember that it was your Son that they took their murderous hands and they killed him. Oh, Heavenly Father, if there ever was a reason to be bitter, it would be for that. Your Son, who'd never done anything wrong, nothing but good, but yet he was beaten, his beard torn from his face, thorns in his head, nails in his hands and feet, and died like a common criminal. Heavenly Father, what a gift that you gave us in allowing that to happen so that we could be redeemed. We are grateful for your Son. We are grateful for every drop of blood that came down off that cross that cleanses us and washes us. And we remember it right now as we partake of communion. We here and those out there that partake with us. Bless us as we do, and may our doing it be a blessing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may partake of the loaf. You may partake of the cup. Hallelujah. It was pointed out to me recently that Pastor Peters has kind of been failing to bring people up to date on some of the events been going on around here. So I've got in here old business. I believe one of the most important things we did this year was the calling down of fire. But then we must remember that the weaponry that was revealed in Branson, Missouri, of binding and loosing is a powerful weapon. We must remember, well, there's been a lot of sermons preached this past year. I think that the calling down of fire was significant, and I can see that what was done there in the spiritual is going to really be made manifest in the physical, I believe, in this coming year. That's just what I'm convicted of. Another piece of old business that I never got back with you on is our ads that we put in the paper in Colorado Springs concerning the queer preacher down there. And you know, calling down that fire, it was just a week or so later that we had another big church down there in Denver. Queer preacher got found out. Well, we've gotten quite a few responses on that ad, didn't we, Richard? About four dozen people writing in from Colorado Springs requesting the stuff that we put out there in the ad. So that's pretty good, close to 50, considering the ads. I don't know what it turns out to be in regards to return on the money, so to speak, but I just think that it was a success, and I want to tell you about that. Also, I think it's been a success in coming against the Catholic Church. One man pointed out to me, he said, you know, your ministry is the only ministry that's got a sizable audience that has come out against that vile, filthy cult. And it's having an effect. The prayers that we have offered up have had an effect. One of the ways is I found personally is that spiritual attacks coming back at you. And I found it interesting that going through some of the mail, this is just some of the old business. It says, Dear Pastor Peters, the imprecatory prayer concerning the Catholic Church has hit a real stronghold, but it is now on its way down. Praise God. When I started praying this prayer, I was attacked by sickness. And I am amazed at being miserable, but really not feeling it. They don't make much sense, but I just don't know how to explain it. There came a wonderful peace in my house all week, and I remember when I prayed the imprecatory prayer, it was a strength and power that was powerful. After praying that, I went into the Bible and prayed away. I prayed every imprecatory prayer I had marked in the Bible. Then I came against all the filth, homos, devils, witches, serpents, and the destruction of the. I can't quite understand this, and I think it reached the throne of God. Anyway, I was awakened by a voice that said, What do you want? And I looked and seen a tall person standing beside my bed. The long gown with a glittering white, beautiful, and it was a side view. I seen what looked like to be a cloak. Then I opened my eyes, and it was gone. And thinking about it, I realized it must have had wings. Anyway, I won't read all of this, but talks about the angel of the Lord encamping around those who fear him. I thought the most interesting thing about that was that they felt physical attack. And I want to tell you that Satan will fight back. And the scripture teaches that. And I had more than one report that people have, when they started praying against that Catholic Church, I've had attacks back, but it was nothing that they can't handle, and you can handle it. I got other old business here, but I think because of where we're at already in the clock, I better get to the sermon. I didn't have a title for this sermon. In fact, I didn't have a sermon. And that's a predicament a preacher sometimes finds himself in on a Saturday night. No sermon at all. You don't know what you're supposed to preach on. And then I got a phone call from a minister, and he said, you know, something just told me to call you and talk to you about a passage in Nehemiah. Well, we had a good visit about the passage in Nehemiah, and he told me what he was going to be doing today in Nehemiah. And so if it's a bad sermon, a bad topic, let's blame it on that preacher. Okay? And if it's a good one, I already told you I can't take credit for it because I felt like that phone call was the leading of the Lord as at least where I'm supposed to be in the Bible to be preaching. Now, I don't know how I would title this, but I'll tell you this. Nehemiah was a man of God, and he was an honorable man. He was a man that's got an entire book in the Bible named after him, and he's a man that couldn't be on the church rolls today in the modern church. Now, there's something wrong with this picture, because he was a man of God and he stood for what is right. He wouldn't be able to be a preacher in a church today or even on the church rolls. Let's go to Nehemiah. There's several scriptures in Nehemiah we're going to look at. Of course, there's a whole 13 chapters, I think, so we can't cover it all. I think we'll start, though, with Nehemiah chapter 8, and I want to say this to my listening audience, and particularly those that have been with us for quite a while, and there are others out there trying to destroy this ministry and this preacher. I want to read to you in Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 2. Then Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly of men, women, and all who could listen with understanding. And I want to say to all of you out there, listen with understanding to this sermon. Because it can still be said today, and things can be told where those that are looking for the truth can hear and understand, and the others are still in the dark. But you got to listen with understanding as I go through this Nehemiah thing. And I want to start now with Nehemiah chapter 1. We get a kind of a take on this. Of course, Nehemiah is the man that God used to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And if you get the feeling like a remnant in a small number, just remember this. The enemy understands that there is something about a man who sets his mind and heart and purpose to do something that it begins to radiate and others begin to do it as well. That's why they will do whatever they can to take out that man. In this case, this man, Nehemiah, determined to rebuild the walls in Jerusalem. And the next thing, you're reading the whole book of Nehemiah about people getting in on this thing, and everybody's working to rebuild the walls. How did it start? I think it's a term called, there's a term for it, slips my mind right now, but it becomes contagious. We start off by saying these words. Verse 1, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Helkiah. Now it happened in the ninth, in the month, Chislev, however you say it, in the 12th year, when I was in Susa, the capital, that Hananiah, one of my brothers, and some men from Judah came, and I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped and had survived the captivity and about Jerusalem. And they said to me, the remnant there in the province who survived the captivity are in great distress and reproach, and the wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. Now it came about, when I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned for days, and I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. Now, Nehemiah was concerned, he was caring. For what? A land and a people, which the Judeo-Christian church world today is say, would say, you have your values in the wrong place. This world is not your home, and Jeremiah was Nehemiah was concerned about his countrymen and his country and his people. You read on in Nehemiah, verse 7. Says, and we have acted very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments and the statutes, but the ordinances which thou didst command thy servant Moses. Remember the word which thou didst command thy servant Moses, saying, If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. The people I have the privilege to minister to understand who the peoples are of the Scriptures, and that God still has His people. When you have that understanding, though they call you racist or bigoted or a Nazi or whatever it might be, when you have that understanding, you have a key to understanding the events in your nation. And here it says that he would scatter them among the peoples. Then he took them out with the Assyrian captivity and scattered them. And he took them out in the Babylonian captivity and scattered them. Today, he has scattered us among the people, but he did it in a different way. He brought the peoples in on us. And so we are now scattered amongst the people in a land that used to be, well, used to be when you said something about China, you thought of a Chinaman, or Japan, you thought of Japanese. You say something about America today, an American today is something entirely different than what you had as an American, say, in the 40s. We've been scattered amongst the people. He was concerned about the land. Going on, verse 8, I've scattered you among the people. You ever heard of the term heartland? Heartland. There is a connection between the heart and the land. People don't understand. First of all, the Bible is clear that he gave in times past the Israelites a great land. He gave our forefathers a great land from sea to shining sea. We've lost that land. In fact, the concept of land isn't even spiritual for the people. But you go back about 70 years in this land, you could travel across eastern Colorado, plains of Nebraska. It didn't make any difference where you were. People were on the land. They were called farms and ranches. They owned them. And there was one every quarter. 160 acres, there'd be a place. But I've heard people say, older people, we were poor, but we didn't know it. And I got thinking about that, and that's not true. They were rich, and they didn't know it. See, Satan just crosses everything out. Because they had their own piece of real estate. And if worse came to worse, when their times were hard, the families could come to the old family homestead. And they got food. And they had a place and they had roots. Today, our children don't even have yards to play in. And no one really seems to care about it. We've got children locked up in apartments and little patio things. They don't even, and if they do find a nice piece of grass called a park, they're not safe to play in it. What has happened? We've been spewed off the land. If you go over to Deuteronomy chapter, we'll come back to Nehemiah. Well, Pastor Peters, that's why we don't listen to you, because you're so unspiritual. This was Nehemiah. He was concerned about the people and the land and what had happened to them in the land that God had given them. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 63, or 26 rather. Deuteronomy 28, verse 26. And they went and served other gods and worshipped them, gods whom they had not known and whom they had not allotted to them. Am I have something wrong? Deuteronomy 28? 28, but 26 doesn't say. Oh, try Deuteronomy 29, 26. Let's see. I'll find it here. No, actually, I wanted Deuteronomy 28:63. And it shall come about that as the Lord delighted over you to prosper you and multiply you, so the Lord will delight over you to make you perish and destroy you, and you will be torn from the land where you're entering to possess it. The other passage would work, but Scripture says if you don't keep the law, the land will spew you out. I don't know, have that scripture real handy, but God tore us from the land because of our sin is what I'm getting at. Going back to Nehemiah in this term of the heartland, I want to go over to Nehemiah chapter 9, because a lot of people have recognized that the land has been taken and they've wondered how to get it back. The scripture that comes to my mind, and I'm looking there now, Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 8. And thou didst find his heart faithful, talking about Abraham, here it is. And thou didst find his heart faithful before thee, and didst make a covenant with him to give him the land of the Canaanites. I want to stop there, and hopefully this makes sense, it ties in, but here was a man, Abraham. And what was he concerned about? A land inheritance. And he was claiming a land inheritance, and how did he get it? His heart was right with God. And as a result, the land became his. It's the same thing we read about in the New Testament. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these other things will be added to you. So I talked about the phrase heartland. Because his heart was right, he got the land. He got it for his children. Does that make sense? Let's go to Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 20. Nehemiah set his mind to rebuild those walls. It says in verse 20, so I answered them and said to them, the God of heaven will give us success. Therefore we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no portion, right, or memorial in Jerusalem. This is another reason he'd never make the church rules, because he was a bit of a separatist, wouldn't you say, when you read the context, and there were others that wanted to help in building the walls. He said, you don't have any part in this. This is not your inheritance. We'll do it ourselves, and our God will help us. The churches today say, come one, come all. That was not Nehemiah's position. Another thing about Nehemiah, if you want to see a radical, you think Pastor Peters is a radical? Go over to Nehemiah chapter 13. He just really would not make the church rolls today. There we read, starting with verse 23, Nehemiah 13:23. In those days, I also saw that the Jews had married women from Ashdod, Ammon, and Moab. As for their children, half spoke in the language of Ashdod, and none of them was able to speak the language of Judah, but the language of his own people. So I contended with them and cursed them and struck some of them and pulled out their hair and made them swear by God, you shall not give your daughters to their sons, nor take their daughters for your sons, for yourselves. Well, here's a man pulling out not his hair, but other people's hair. And he is coming down hard on the people. Now, would you say that's a radical? You'd think this Nehemiah would make it in the church rolls today? No, no way. He cared about the land. He cared about his people doing the work that they're supposed to do and excluding others. And he wasn't embracing the miscegenation that we have today. So, I go now to Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 8, or verse 9, rather, with the word but. Let's pick it up in 8 again. Remember the word which thou didst command thy servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though those of you who have been scattered were in the most remote part of the heavens, I will gather them from there and will bring them to the place where I have chosen to cause my name to dwell. That's a pretty encouraging scripture to me in verse 9. I will bring them to the place. And I think that God is going to take his people and bring them to the place they're supposed to be as far as being right by him. And it's coming. Nehemiah understood that God fights for us. In Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 20, we read these words. And whatever place you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us. They were against overwhelming odds. But Nehemiah went into this thing knowing this, is that our God will fight for us. Now, what we need to see there is the word fight. The enemy fights back. But if you stay faithful, he will fight for you, and they cannot succeed. Nehemiah understood that. Nehemiah 9, verse 30 is where we go to next. However, thou didst bear with them for many years and admonish them by the Spirit through thy prophets. I also want you to notice in Nehemiah chapter 9, the words in verse 26. And they became disobedient and rebelled against thee, and cast thy law behind their backs, and killed the prophets who had admonished them, so that they might return to them, and they committed great blasphemies. I've underlined that myself because this is what they do. When Satan has the battle come back at you, first person they want to take out is the prophet. Our people kill prophets because the spirit of the prophet admonishes the people to get their values right again, and so they've got to kill the prophet. There's more than one way in trying to kill the prophet, by the way. And one of the ways is through slander. I just got a note here. Our internet's down. I really find that unfortunate because I'd like to have the internet up when I'm giving this. But it was no accident, I don't think, that this preacher happened to stumble on the 91st day, the words in the Septuagint on the Psalm in Psalms 91 that he delivers from tumultuous accusations. Next thing you go along, and the next thing you know, there'll be an attack, and the accusations are tumultuous accusations. Well, it's one of the ways to try to kill the prophet's voice. When we hold our leadership workshop, one thing I want to talk to the men about is slander, libelous remarks, tumultuous accusations. There's a growth process as a Christian leader that you go through. I told you in the last sermon that about that paper called The Oracle and how they would put out these horrible stories about Pastor Peters and La Porte Church of Christ and how we responded to that. But as time goes on, you learn to just start putting it in the area of the arena of prayer. But also, when these things happen to you in your earlier Christian walk, you become anxious and concerned about what this is going to do to you. Well, then you get over that. The maturity is, as time goes on, you become anxious and concerned, and you have to fight that anxiety as to what it will do to the innocent. Because you figure out over the years, it doesn't do anything to you. I mean, you still go on. It's the innocent that are taken in by it that you care about. Does that make sense? Well, I'm trying to make sense of that. Let me have you go over to Revelation chapter 3. See if I can find this real fast. Revelation 3, verse 18. He says, I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire, that you may become rich, and white garments, that you may clothe yourself, and that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and eye salve to anoint your eyes that you may see. What does it mean here to buy from me gold refined by fire? I think the answer to that is found in 1 Peter chapter 1. Starting with verse 6. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now, for a little while, if necessary, you've been distressed by various trials, that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. I believe the gold that Revelation 3:18 is talking about is the gold you buy. A lot of people don't buy this. They think, well, if I become a Christian, there's to be no problems. That's not true. That gold refined by fire is the fiery trials that God has you go through for the testing of your faith. And one of those has to do with sometimes you have to forego, or what's the word I want? You have to go through false, tumultuous accusations. But you grow in the fact that Well, I'll be all right, but I don't want other innocent people hurt. But unfortunately, because the people do not take seriously the instructions of not receiving an accusation against an elder, except at the mouth of two or three witnesses, they do get hurt. The prophet doesn't get hurt. They're the ones that get hurt. And that's something I wanted to teach the men. Here recently, there was a little article in a little paper that came out. They had very little truth. The only truth they had in it was my name. Now, I haven't read the article. You say, well, how do you know about it? Well, as we discussed in Sunday school class this morning, others that have read the article, came out a couple weeks ago. But the remark was the only thing accurate on it was my name. It was absolutely preposterous. Yet that article, but taken by the enemies of truth, has been faxed, copied, mailed, find out what was said. And I thought, told my wife, I said, why would I care what's being said when I should have been making a journal over the years of all the things that have been said about me? I think I told you one time I turned on the television set on the A&E channel, and they had a program called, the A&E channel had a program called the New Faces of Terrorism. And, well, this looks like something intelligent to watch. And I'm sitting there, and guess whose face was the new face of terrorism? Broadcast nationwide. I'm the terrorist. And when you've been on Inside Edition, and you've been in Newsweek, and things like that, why would you care about what some little podunk holler news article said? There was no truth about it at all. But it's hard to tell the difference between a witch and a bitch. If you think about it, they're spelled very similar. But the fruit's about the same. But in witchcraft, they make sure that they spread out all the slander and libelous material they can on you. And it can be very embarrassing and degrading. That's what they want to do to you. Because this is sent to friends and family and that type of thing. I've been through this before more than once. It's like the old song, "This Ain't My First Rodeo." But you know something? When it's all said and done, I'm still here. But it's not that I'm concerned about myself. I'm concerned about those that are so foolishly and so easily taken in. Our people, of all people, should know that you cannot believe the media. They should know that. But yet, you know, I think there might be a ring of truth that. You know what I've heard? I've heard this, that, and just blah, 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 blah. And it's all because you disregard what the Lord has put out very seriously. You don't receive an accusation against a man of God except at the mouth of two or three witnesses. He won't go down. You will go down. You just well take that warning right now. Now, a friend of mine once years ago said, you know, you never have to worry about it. These are things I want to teach some of the men in the leadership workshop, things that you learn the hard way and other men teach you. But he said, don't ever worry about it, because he says, your friends won't believe it and your enemies already do. And it's really true. Nothing really changes, except you do kind of have some of the naive, innocent ones on the outside, they get taken out sometimes, and it's unfortunate for them. Anyway, at that part of Nehemiah where it says that they kill the prophets, they try to kill the prophets. They try to turn people against them. They do anything they can to keep people from listening to them. Let's go to Nehemiah. And as I said, you need to listen to with understanding. Nehemiah chapter 9. And sometimes we have to go through things in order to be able to teach other people things. We are living in the land now, just like they're living in the land, the same circumstances. Starting with Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 33. However, thou art just in all that has come upon us, for thou hast dealt faithfully, but we have acted wickedly. For our kings, our leaders, our priests, and our fathers have not kept thy law, or paid attention to thy commandments and thy admonitions with which thou hast admonished them. But they in their own kingdom, with thy great goodness which thou didst give them, with the broad and rich land which thou didst set before them, did not serve thee or turn from their evil deeds. Behold, we are slaves today, and as to the land which thou didst give to our fathers to eat of its fruit and its bounty, behold, we are slaves on it. And the abundant produce is for the kings, whom thou hast set over us because of our sin. They also rule over our bodies and over our cattle as they please, so we are in great distress. Notice there that Nehemiah described what we have today. They rule over our cattle. Do you know, I was talking to a friend of mine in Michigan. He can't move his cows off of his land without a certain tag. And they've got every animal recorded there. And they're working to do the same thing everywhere. And it says that they also rule over our bodies. We are in a situation today that I think all my people need to be aware of. And that is that you've got to be slow to speak, swift to hear, and slow to anger. Because the alien watchers and the whole system is there to rule over your body. I give you a couple illustrations. I remember years ago, a young man had a little baby girl. His wife took the little baby girl to the doctor because she had a rash on her backside. And doctor gave some cream, took the baby home. Both the mother and father were not big people. And the baby was not a large baby for its age. God makes everything different size, and the doctor weighed it, but she made the remark of letting the doctor know she hadn't gotten vaccinations for the child. There's no law in that state that they have to have vaccinations. They didn't want vaccinations for that child for good reason. So a few weeks later, or a week or so later, the doctor's office calls. Said, the doctor wants you to bring the little baby in. And the mother said, well, I don't need to. The rash is gone and the baby's fine. Now, that doctor, as part of the system here, that doctor took, you got to treat them like gods. Or there's an attitude there. So anyway, next thing the young man knew was the social services was after his baby because the doctor reported that was underweight. And they came out there with sheriff deputies to get the child. What are we talking about? We're talking about ruling over our bodies. Now listen with understanding. Today, you can take a family member to the hospital, like an emergency room. And if the little snaky-looking doctor says, well, we're going to have to keep this person in overnight. And say you don't want your mate to be in the hospital overnight, because hospitals in and of themselves can be somewhat dangerous in many different ways. And you don't have insurance anyway, and you don't see a need for it. And you argue with the doctor, that doctor can call cops and they'll have you arrested. Because when the cops come in, if you have an attitude like, hey, you know, this is my wife, we'll do what we want, and they touch you on the arm, say, come with us, and you pull your arm back, that's interference. Automatic $750 bond that you have to lay out. And you can find yourself being handcuffed, might say rather roughly. And book the whole works. Why? Because they are ruling over your body. So I say to you, be as wise as serpents and harmless as doves. I understand why Jesus just shut his mouth, didn't do anything once they had him in their grips, because they want to hurt you. They want to control you. And then they want to take and slander and libel a prophet's voice. Does that make sense? What is it? It's just this. They also rule over our bodies and over our cattle as they please. So we are in great distress. And so it goes on in the world today, and you just got to learn, be slow to speak, swift to hear, and slow to anger. Then it goes on to say, now because of all this, we are making an agreement in writing, and on the sealed document are the names of our leaders, our Levites, and our priests. Well, the man that called and told me about Nehemiah, he said, you know what I'm going to do with my congregation? He said, I'm going to have them sign a statement. Now, I'm thinking that there's something about a signature that's all yours and nobody else's. I'm just going to take and write my name right underneath there, sign it, right underneath Nehemiah 9:38, because I don't know what was in that agreement, but I know that that agreement was, we're going to get things right and do things right. He said he's going to have his congregation sign this statement he had for him. Heavenly Father, I willingly offer myself this last day of December 2006 to be obedient to you in all that you require of me in 2007. With joy and great delight, I desire to perform your word, follow the guidance of your Holy Spirit, and inherit the kingdom you have prepared for me from the foundation of the world. And his congregation is going to sign that. I just decided, well, I just sign it right here. Nehemiah was a wall builder. He set his mind, regardless of what the odds were, and as a result, the land did change. I suggest that you make sure that that's the way you enter into 2007. Some change is coming. I think it was initiated in the spiritual in 2006, and I suspect in 2007 we're going to see a lot in the earthly. This might not have been the best sermon in the world, but I think the truths in it are appropriate for today. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we set our mind to build those walls, knowing that if you are for us, who can be against us? quite a story in Nehemiah that I read last night. Didn't necessarily do justice with it today. But the bottom line, Father, is we're concerned about the great distress that we find ourselves in because of the sins of our fathers and ourselves. And we make this covenant with you, Father, that we want to rebuild the walls. We want to have a land again for our people, our children. So be with us and help us as we strive to carry out your will in the years to come, not knowing what is coming for sure, but that victory is ours and we claim it in the name of Jesus. And in the name of Jesus, I say, bless those that are yours. Bless them and keep them. Make your face shine upon them. Be gracious to them. Lift your countenance upon them and grant them peace. In Jesus' name, amen.